Amen.
Amen.
God's been good to us.
Amen.
And I thank the Lord for our mothers.
Amen.
And I mentioned it earlier, they weren't in the building, but I thank the Lord for my wife. And a lot of men can't say this. I thank the Lord for my mother-in-law.
Amen. Amen.
I heard of this is not my mother-in-law. I've got a wonderful, loving mother-in-law. I heard of a guy who was with his wife, and his wife ran up to him and said, they were going camping. And she said, honey, there's a tiger in my mama's tent. And he said, the tiger got himself into that. He got to get himself out of it. That's not the case. That's not the case with my mother-in-law. We love her. And she's a good mother-in-law. My wife is a wonderful wife. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. John chapter 2. Take your Bibles and go to John chapter 2. Thank you, Sister Stenson. John chapter 2. We're going to zero in on one verse, but I'm going to read these first 11 verses for context purposes. Message that focuses on mothers, but this is for everybody. And you'll see, so do not tune it out. If you say, I'm a man or I'm not a mother, this is the word of God for each and every one of us, and it will be applicable to each and every one. But in John chapter 2, and beginning at verse number 1, the Bible says, and the third day there was a marriage in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. And both Jesus was called and his disciples to the marriage. And when they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus saith unto him, they have no wine. Jesus saith unto her, woman, what have I to do with thee? Mine hour is not yet come. His mother saith unto the servants, whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. There were set there 6 water pots of stone, after the manner of the purifying of the Jews, containing 2 or 3 firkins apiece. And Jesus saith unto them, fill the water pots with water. And they filled them up to the brim. And he saith unto them, draw out now, and bear unto the governor of the feast. And they bear it. When the ruler of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine, and knew not whence it was, but the servants which drew the water knew, the governor of the feast called the bridegroom, and saith unto him, every man at the beginning doth set forth good wine, and men have well drunk, then that which is worse. But thou hast kept the good wine until now. Until now. We'll stop right there. But I want to draw your attention to verse number 5. And that verse simply says, his mother, Jesus' mother, saith unto the servants, whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. Whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. This morning, I want to preach to you a message I've entitled this, The Best Advice Any Mother Ever Gave. The best advice any mother ever gave. Let's go to our Father in prayer. Father, we thank you again for our mothers, the gift of our mothers that you've given to us. Lord, now we want to focus on you and do exactly what Mary instructed. Whatever you say, we want to do it. So in this very moment, I pray that you will guide and direct and have your will and way. Give me the words and the wisdom for this time and give each one of us ears to hear that which you would have us to hear. Bless us. Challenge us through your word this morning. We ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. The best advice any mother ever gave. You know, some of the best advice, some of the best teaching that a person can get comes from their mama. I think you would agree with me on that. Someone wrote a list of some things that their mother taught them. I've probably used this a few years ago, but I like it. This person said, my mother taught me logic. If you fall off that swing and break your neck, you can't come with me to the store. My mother taught me humor. When that lawnmower cuts off your toes, don't come running to me. My mother taught me genetics. You're just like your father. My mother taught me anticipation. Just wait until your daddy gets home. My mother taught me about religion. You better pray that stain comes off that carpet. My mother taught me about stamina. You're just going to sit there until you eat all them greens. Eat all that spinach. My mother taught me about the circle of life. I brought you into this world. Y'all say the rest of it. I can take you out. And this person said the all-time favorite thing my mother taught me was justice. One day you're going to have kids, and I hope they just like you, and you'll see how it is. I can't wait. Mothers can teach us much, and mothers can give great advice. While our Lord is the wonderful counselor, I think a lot of us are experienced enough, and we've been around our mothers enough to know they can give us wonderful counsel. Well, in the case of John chapter 2, the servants at this Galilean wedding got some advice from a mother. And I'm so glad they did, because it is really the best advice that any mother could ever give. In verse 5, the mother's name is Mary, is Jesus' mother. And she said, whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. I'll give you the context of what's going on before we dive into the message. Jesus, the Bible says, his mother and Jesus' disciples were at a wedding celebration. Perhaps this was the bride or the groom, may have been related to Jesus and Mary, and that's why they were there. You'll see Mary was very much involved in this wedding. It's in a little obscure village by the name of Cana in Galilee. Nazareth, where Jesus grew up, is not too far from Cana. Nazareth was a backwoods town. Not a lot of people lived there. A lot of people say Cana may have just had 100 people that lived in that little village. Well, the wine for all the guests had run out, which in that day and culture was a serious shame to the host families and to that bridegroom. To fail to completely provide for the guests was not just embarrassing, but it was disgraceful. For you see, that bridegroom had been away in the betrothal period for a year preparing for to take his bride for himself. And this would be a good indication that ladies, the bride's father would look at this man and say, listen, if he can't take care of this, I don't think he can take care of my little sweet daughter. And it would be an old embarrassment for years to come on the name of this family. And so this is a big deal. This is a little town with a wedding, and this is a major deal. You may not understand it, but this would have been humiliating. When they ran out of the wine, this was something major. It was a big deal. And so this prompts Mary to go to her son, Jesus, who hadn't, listen, I want you to understand, he hadn't performed any miracles up to this point. He was just beginning his earthly ministry. And so with no miracles behind him, she asked him to do something about the situation. And this led Jesus to do his first miracle, turning the water into wine. But let me say this, that wine of that day was not exactly like the wine of our day. And I see some of you licking your chops, but they weren't going down on whiskey and gin and tonic and doing any of that stuff. I'll quote you a scripture too, unless you want to leave this place saying, I'm going to go get crunk when I leave. The Bible says in Proverbs 20, verse 1, wine is a mocker. Strong drink is raging, and whosoever is deceived thereby is not wise. Amen. Church got quiet. Can I get an amen? Amen. I'll give you one more verse and we'll move right along in the message. Ephesians 5:18 says, be not drunk with wine, but you better be filled with the Spirit.
Amen.
The intent of this message is not to break down this entire miracle. I read 11 verses, but I want to break down those seven words that Mary spoke in verse 5. She said, whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. Let's take these seven words. I'm going to take them apart. I almost go one by one, and I want us to look at the best advice any mother has ever given. Let me say one more thing before we start. The Catholic religion would have you to think that Mary was a co-mediator or even a co-savior with Jesus, but that's not true. Mary, although Jesus was her son, she needed Jesus to be her savior, just like me and you. She had to repent of her sins because Mary was a sinner. And she had to come to Jesus to be her Lord and Savior, the same way that you and me had to do. But in this case, we can at least look to Mary as a good example and an excellent counselor, as she tells us, whatever he says, you better do it. Mary is going to teach us some things. First of all, the first point I want us to notice this morning, I want us to think about the scope of this advice. And by that, I mean the reach, the extent of this advice, the scope of this advice. For the first word used there in verse number 5 is whatsoever. Whatsoever. And so this is an all-inclusive word, whatsoever. Brother Dre, can you see, Brother Lorenzo may have to step out. I don't want to put you on the spot, but if he's not back there, can you run the board for me? I would really appreciate it. And if he's there, that's fine. The scope of this advice, the word says whatsoever. This is an all-inclusive word. And whatever he tells you, that's what whatsoever means. Thank you, Brother Dre. It means anything and everything that he tells you, do it. That's what I mean. It's all inclusive. The scope, nothing is excluded. When you go to Jesus, whatever he tells you, do it. There's no limits. There's no boundaries. There's no exceptions. Do anything and do everything Jesus commands you to do. Now, that's some good advice. Amen.
Amen.
That's some good advice in our day. Mary, the mother of Jesus, gave this good advice. I said it again, but I hope you understand. Keep in mind, this was the first miracle Jesus ever performed. Mary goes to these servants, and says, listen, we've run out of wine. Whatever Jesus tells you to do, do it. And what you have to understand, they had nothing to base their decision on. There'd been no blind man healed up to this point. Jesus had not been involved in that miracle of the multiplication of the fish and the bread. That hadn't happened, the feeding of the 5,000. He'd never cleansed any lepers up to this point. There's no miracles that they could base their confidence in this Jesus on. Listen, Lazarus, Jesus had not raised him from the dead at this point. And also notice that Jesus did not give these servants any indication of what he was going to do to get this wine in this celebration. He just said in verse number 6, he said, get these 6 water pots. I'm sorry, not verse number 6. But he tells them, and it is verse number 6, to get these 6 water pots of stone after the manner of the purifying of the Jews. That was the water pots they would use in their ceremonial purification. And Jesus said, fill, in verse 7, the water pots with water. They may have thought, listen, well, what's that got to do with wine? They may have thought to themselves, what's that got to do? How's that going to help our situation? Your mama said they've run out of wine. You say get these water pots. You say fill water in them. We don't need water. We need wine. Who are you? How's that going to help us in our situation? For them, it may have sounded crazy what Jesus was telling them to do. It made no sense to them what Jesus was telling them to do. But Mary said, whatever he tells you, just do it. Just obey it. If you think about it, this is not the first time that God has given an unusual instruction. Remember, he told Moses, you put the blood of the lamb over the doorposts and the angel will pass over you. Didn't make sense, but we're going to just paint that blood on it and trust you, Jesus, God. Told Naaman, dip 7 times in that Jordan River and you'll receive your healing and your cleansing. He told Israel one time when they had rebelled and were bitten by serpents, he said, make a bronze serpent and if you look to the serpent, you'll be healed, you'll be saved. Remember, he told the priest to take up the Ark of the Covenant, step your foot in that water at flood stage when the water is raging, and then I'm gonna part the water. It may not have made sense to them. What'd he tell Joshua and the children of Israel? March around that walled city and begin to shout, and the walls are gonna come tumbling down. My point is this, from the human perspective, none of those things seem to make any sense. But I'm going to tell you this, when you simply do whatever the Lord tells you to do, you'll understand that even if it doesn't make sense to you, it makes sense to him. And he knows what he's doing, and he'll have his will and way, and he'll do what only he can do in your life. Listen, if it makes no sense to a natural man that the only way that your sins can be forgiven is to look by faith to a nail-scarred carpenter from Nazareth by the name of Jesus, and then your sins will be forgiven. Listen, there's a lot of people that that's too easy. It doesn't make sense. But listen, you found those who are saved. When you put your faith in Jesus, he's completely changed you,
amen,
giving you a new life. Doesn't make sense. Listen, I've got to work my way into heaven. I've got to do this or that. And Jesus says, no, you come with your filthy rags and you lay them at my feet and put your faith in me, and by my grace, I'll take you to heaven.
Amen.
Doesn't seem to make sense many times, but Jesus knows what he's doing. Mary teaches us that we're to walk by faith and not by sight. We're to walk by faith and not by sight. So when things don't make sense, or if what Jesus today, listen friend, if he, what he's telling you to do wasn't in your plans, just trust him and do what he tells you to do. Just trust and obey him and he will reward your faith. Listen, if he's calling you to serve him today, you better serve him. He knows what he's doing. He's calling you to serve him. You do that and Jesus will turn that water into wine in your life. Whatever he's telling you to give, whatever he's telling you to do, to follow this great maternal advice that we get from Mary, the mother of Jesus, we have to be willing to simply say this: Jesus, I'm going to do what you've told me to do. I'm going to do what you've told me to do, whatever it is, wherever it is, whatever the cost, wherever it leads. And so we see the scope of this request that Mary made, whatever, whatever. But secondly, I want you to notice the specifics of this advice. The specifics of this advice. She said, whatever he saith. Whatever he saith. Listen, Mary said, whatever Jesus, and she pointed at Jesus, whatever this man tells you to do, do it. She didn't leave any room for guessing. She said, go to Jesus, go to him. She gave him the specifics, and whatever he saith, you need to do. She pointed them specifically to Jesus. Now, as we think about the specifics of Mary's advice that rings true in our life today, understand that first of all, this advice that she said, it involved the Savior. This advice involved the Savior. She said, whatsoever he, and again, that he is Jesus. Now, I'm going to say this, you should obey those that enforce the law. You should, children, you ought to obey your parents in the Lord. That's what the Bible says. You should submit to those who are in authority over you, shouldn't you? Church, come on. Amen. You should do these things. But the truth is, sometimes each one of these parties, each one of these people that I just mentioned, they can be wrong sometimes.
All right.
They can hurt you. They can lead you astray. But what Mary was doing, she was pointing them to the God-man, and she said, do whatever he says. But unlike a judge, and unlike the law enforcement, and unlike even your parents, this man that she pointed them to could not lead you astray, had never made a mistake, could not make a mistake, and he will always lead you in the right direction. She pointed them to Jesus. And so it involved the Savior. She pointed them to the Savior. Jesus could do no wrong. My wife and I were marveling just earlier this past week, maybe a couple of weeks ago, over the fact that children, little babies, and specifically we're thinking about our little Jairus, he's the youngest, how they seem to always say, learn and say the word no before they ever learn to say the word yes. Isn't that right? And something we notice. They always seem to learn to shake their head before they learn to nod their head yes. I mean, Jairus can be going to town on a bowl of oatmeal and enjoying it. And you say, Jairus, are you enjoying the oatmeal? And he'll say, Matter of fact, he did something to me the other day that shocked me. I said, he added some emphasis to his no. The little baby, no. They say, no. And I asked him one day, he threw his spoon. I said, Jairus, don't throw your spoon. He said, no. I said, we don't need all that. Takes after his mother. And so that's a joke. On Mother's Day, that's a joke. But I brought that up because Danielle, she made this point. She said, you know, the only baby that never started off not shaking the head and saying no and slapping you upside the face was baby Jesus, because he was the sinless Son of God. And I don't know if Mary was expecting a miracle in this situation, Brother Ray. Christ had not done a miracle. So she may have been. I'm not saying she wasn't. But perhaps she was just expecting Jesus to come through and do something, because think about it, he never had a bad idea in his life. That's Jesus. And so maybe she practically thought, listen, we've run out of wine. Jesus, my son, my oldest son, there's something I need you to do. She wanted Jesus to save the day, is what she did. She may have understood it, maybe she didn't understand the full ramifications of it, but she really did go to the Savior, and he wouldn't just save the day, he would save all mankind from their sins.
Amen.
If they put their trust in him. Mary took those servants to the Savior, is what she did. And Jesus said, listen, and Mary said, do whatever my son Jesus tells you to do. Mary understood that Jesus can never lead you astray. Now, talk about great advice from Mary. Go to the Savior. That's what she said. Go to Jesus, the one that has all knowledge, the one that has all wisdom and all intellect and all power and all love. She pointed them to Jesus. Listen, mother, the best thing you can do is point your children to Jesus. Go to Jesus. Her advice was go to the Savior. The specifics of her advice didn't just involve going to the Savior, but it also involved the Scripture. Her advice involved the Scripture. She said, whatsoever he, look at this one word, saith. What Mary, the mother of Jesus, was really saying was this: in this predicament that we're in, go to Jesus because he has a word for you, is what she was saying. Whatsoever he saith, he's got a word. He's going to speak something. He's going to say something to you. Pay attention to what he has to say, is what Mary was saying. Go to what we know as the Bible says in the beginning was the word. She was pointing them to go to the living word.
Amen.
Go to Jesus in this predicament. Listen, that same principle applies to all of us in here today. Jesus, I know he's not physically with us for us to audibly hear him speak to us. But listen, he is the living word. But you can go to Jesus today and hear from him when you go to the written word, the Bible. Go to Jesus and go to the word. And listen, I'm telling you this, in God's word, in this Bible, he's still speaking. He's speaking to you today. He's speaking to you even in this service. As I speak, we have his word and he's speaking to you. He's speaking to you. Listen, if you want to hear the voice of God, you say, I want to hear the voice of God. I'll tell you what to do. Pick up your Bible and read it.
Amen.
You want to hear the voice of God? Read your Bible. Listen, if you want to know God's will, read your Bible. Now think about it. In order for those servants to know what to do in their situation, this is going to be embarrassing. They're servants of this bridegroom. This is going to be embarrassing to his family and to this in this little community. They don't know what to do. Mary says, go to Jesus and do whatever he saith. Listen to the words of Jesus and then you'll find direction. And so in order for them to get instruction to do what to do next in the problem of life that they were facing, they had to hear the word of God. They had to hear the word of God. For you to know how to operate in your life, you know what you have to hear? The word of God. What's scripture? Faith cometh by what? Hearing. And hearing by the word of God. Listen, many people want to know God's will for their life, but they don't make God's word a part of their life. And you're groping in the darkness today because you're not in the word of God. You don't sit under the preaching of the word of God. You don't get the teaching of the word of God in you. But listen, his will and his way can only be found in his word.
Amen.
His will and way. Listen, I'll tell you what his will for you is. I found it in the scripture, Colossians 3:16. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom. Why? Because the Bible says in Psalm 119, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I'm telling you, if you're not walking in the word of God, you're stumbling around in the darkness. There's no light for your feet. There's no a lamp for your feet and a light for your path. Only God's word illuminates the path. So now you know where to go. You know how to operate in life. You know how to base your decisions. But it only comes from the word of God. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Mamas, praise the Lord for you mothers who have your children in the house of God.
Amen.
Who bring your children to the church house and who try to teach your children the things of God. Listen, because in order to make wise decisions, all of us want our children to make wise decisions. I'm going to tell you this, I want you to hear it well. In order to make wise decisions, you have to have wise counsel.
Right.
Not going to get those wise decisions from Jay-Z and Beyonce. You're not going to get those wise decisions out from guys on the street and out in the world. They can lead you astray. But you get your children under the word of God and in the house of God and under the teaching of God. And you feed them God's word. And there they'll find wise counsel. I know it's up to them. But the Bible says you train up a child in the way they should go. And when they're old, they'll be coming back. You just train them up. And then you give them to Jesus. And I want to personally thank the mothers that have done sacrifice and tried to do the best that they could in training up their children in God's word, pointing to the scripture. These people, they would have run out of wine and nothing would have happened if these servers didn't hear the word of God and listen to it. Direction from God is more important than anything that you can get. Now, I hear people that get upset and they say, listen, my mama or my daddy made me go to church, and they're upset about it. Funny thing is, your mama made you go to school too. Your boss makes you come to work. I don't hear anyone complaining. All these things, you get made to do all kind of stuff in life. The reason you get upset because mama made you go to church is because it gets a little uncomfortable when you hear the word of God that tells you about yourself. I'm just telling you this, there ought to be no complaints. I don't feel bad for anyone that mama and daddy made them go to church, because that's where you ought to be. Because again, there's no better counsel that you can get. There's no counsel at all that you can get apart from the word of God.
Amen.
I'm glad my mom and daddy made me go to church. If I stood up to them and said I ain't going, I would have woke up in the church house because they would have knocked me out. We have the word of God, and so she said, whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. The scope of this advice, whatsoever. The specifics of this advice, whatsoever he saith. Jesus, listen to his word. And finally, think about the simplicity of this advice. The simplicity of this advice. She said, whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. What's Nike say? Just do it. The advice from Jesus' mother to those at the wedding was simple. It's simple. It's still simple advice today. She may say, listen, I don't know what my son's going to tell you. I don't know what Jesus is going to tell you. But whatever he tells you, simply just do it. Just do it. Listen, you don't have to have a PhD in theology to understand that. What Jesus says, just do it. Ask the Holy Spirit. Ask God to help you. And when you ask him to help you, he'll give you the strength you need. He'll enable you to do exactly what you have to do. So what we find is that there's some things we can learn in this message, in this lesson in Mary's advice that'll teach us how we ought to operate in life. First of all, when Mary said, do it, whatever he says unto you, just do it. What she was saying is this, listen to what he says. Just listen to what he says. She said, notice those two words, unto you. Unto you. She's getting personal. She said, listen, servants, we've run out. You know how a lady gets, there's a party and you're running out of stuff and it's starting to get a little frantic, and I'm sure Mary was getting a little stressed, and she just said, listen, whatever he says unto you, listen, sir, whatever he says to you, I want you to listen. Listen to what he says. But I want you to know something. Mary had to learn this lesson for herself first, and I'll show it to you. She had to learn that she had to listen to what he says first before she could do anything further. This whole conversation began with Mary coming to tell Jesus to do something about the shortage of wine in verse 3. Mary is perhaps, some say she could have been the wedding director, the caterer, or at least a close family friend. And she comes to Jesus telling him what to do in verse number 3. And when they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus saith unto him, they have no wine. Jesus, they have no wine. The implication is simply, really, she's saying this, Jesus, do something. Son, that was her son, do something. And notice what Jesus replied. He replied by asking in verse 4, woman, what have I to do with thee? Mine hour is not yet come. Now some of you say, Mother's Day, Jesus was being a little disrespectful to his mama. Jesus was not being rude or disrespectful to his mother. That term, the word woman, in that time was a term of respect. We would say ma'am today. That's what Jesus wasn't talking back coming back at his mother. He was saying, listen, woman, but notice he didn't say mother. He did call her woman, and he did that for a reason. What Jesus was doing was revealing to his mother that their relationship was now changing. You have to understand this. Jesus, he was basically saying, now I've come, John, my cousin John the Baptist baptized me. The Holy Spirit came upon me and rested upon me and said, basically, mama, what you're about to say, this is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. Hear ye him. Listen to him. But he says, mother, I'm now at the stage of life where it's time for me to not be about your business, but I've got to be about my father's business.
Amen.
This is what's happening in this passage. And mother, I'm not here to do your will, but I have to do my father's will. I'm not on your schedule anymore, mother. I love you. And if you don't think Jesus loved and respected his mother, look at John 19 when he was on the cross in pain. And one of the things that he did, he said, listen, mother, behold your son. That's John. The woman, behold your son. And John, behold your mother. He was still looking out for his mother. He loved his mother. But he said, listen, I'm not on your schedule. I'm on a divine schedule. This is leading me to the cross. One commentator pointed out this about Mary's approach, about trying to get something from Jesus. Mary approaches Jesus as his mother. I'm your mama. And she didn't get what she requested. But when she responded as a believer, and when I say that, there was no argument with Jesus. If you look at verse number 4 and verse number 5, she said, do something in verse 3. They have no wine. Verse 3. And then in verse 4, Jesus says, woman, what have I to do with thee? Mine hour is not yet come. And then the Bible in verse number 5 doesn't say married to, but listen, you, boy, I told you what to do. That's not there. Mary didn't put up a fight. What Mary did, she humbled herself. And Mary just said this, listen, whatever he tells you, just do it. Whatever he tells you, just do it. So I'm going to say it again. When Mary approached Jesus as his mother, she didn't get what she requested. But when she approached Jesus by faith and as a believer, her faith was honored. So Mary comes saying, do something. And nothing happens. And then she, in essence, she says, Jesus, tell us what to do. Some of y'all don't get this. She first said, Jesus, do something. And Jesus said, listen, that's not how the approach is to go. And then Mary, next thing she says is, tell us what to do. Whatever he says, do it. And when she took that approach, Lord, tell me what to do. Tell us what to do. Jesus worked on her behalf.
Amen.
Oh, listen, do you want him to speak to you today? Or are you more interested in him hearing what you have to say? A lot of us are saying this, Jesus, do something. Listen, Lord, do something. Listen, the predicament that you're in, you're saying, Jesus, do something. But what he's waiting for you to do is say this, Lord, what would you have me to do? And he's saying, I want you to have faith in me. I want you to trust and obey me. You have to listen to what Jesus says. But too many people are saying, listen, do something, Lord. Do this, do that. But what Jesus is saying, I want you to step back and say, Lord, whatever you say, as Mary said, I want to do. And God will move on your behalf as only he can. But he's waiting for you to say, Jesus, tell me what to do. I want to hear from you. And when we get to that point, he will move in a special way on our behalf. In Mary's simple advice, she is saying, listen to what he says to you. But she's also saying this, the final thought I want to say is, live out what he says to you. Don't just listen to what he says, live out what he says. Notice Mary didn't just say, whatever he says to you, hear it. She didn't say just say that. Whatever he says to you, believe it. All those things are important and implied. But Mary says, whatever he says, just do it. Just do it. Just do it. You know, a few years later, I find this interesting. Mary had another son by the name of James. That was Jesus' half-brother. Mary had a son by the name of James who wrote in the book of James, chapter 2, verse 17, faith without works is dead. In other words, just don't sit around talking about, listen, I hear what Jesus is saying, but there ought to be some action in our life as well.
Amen.
James said in James 1:22, just don't be hearers of the word of God, but be ye doers.
Amen.
Listen to this, mother. Perhaps James heard his mama's advice to those men way back then at Cana when Jesus about to perform his first miracle. And she said, listen, don't just hear what he says, but do it. Whatever he says, whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. And God used that mama. I know the Holy Spirit inspired James to write these words, but perhaps it was on the memory of his mother's advice to those men, because a godly mother said, turn to Jesus and listen to Jesus. James said, listen, don't just be a hearer, but be a doer.
Amen.
Oh, mother, you never know what advice that you give to your children, that godly advice that stays with them.
Yes.
My mother taught me a prayer when I was a little boy. Simple. She said, remember, son, pray this. Lord, help me to hate all evil and love all good.
Yes.
It's simple prayer.
Amen.
There have been times in my life where I wanted to get my hands on some evil. And that prayer came back to me. And I had to say, Lord, I need your help. Help me to, that prayer mama taught me when I was 8 years old. Help me to hate all evil and love all good. Listen, the point is live out. Whatever he says to you, do it. Live out what he says to you. That was Mary's advice. Mary's advice led to many people seeing the glory of God. A great miracle of water into wine took place. And they also learned the lesson that Jesus is better is really what they learned in this passage. Jesus had them fill out those 6 water pots. And then Jesus said in verse 8, draw out now and bear unto the governor of the feast. And somewhere in all this, the water was miraculously turned into wine before it reached the lips of the man in charge of the marriage celebration. And listen, this was a genuine miracle. This was a genuine miracle. Brother Ray, it wasn't like the country preacher that was driving erratically and he got pulled over by the cop. You've heard this one. And the cop asked him if he'd been drinking. He was embarrassed. He's trying to figure out a way to get out of it. The preacher said, listen, I've just been drinking water this whole time. And the cop came over to the other side and saw a bottle of wine. He looked in it and it was wine. And he told the preacher, I see what's in there. It's wine. The preacher didn't know what to do. He's trying to get out of it. He looked surprised. He said, Jesus done did it again.
Wow.
Jesus performed a real miracle here. He turned the water into the wine. Some of you get that at lunchtime. But I want you to notice what the lesson that they learned, listen to Jesus, but the lesson I'm drawing to a close, Jesus is better. And here's why I find that. Look at what the ruler of the feast says when he takes this wine. In verse number 10, it says, "And saith unto him, Every man at the beginning doth set forth good wine. And when men have well drunk, then which is worse?" In other words, you give them the good stuff first, and then when that's over with, then you give them the worst. But he said, "But thou hast kept the good wine until now. You saved the best for last." Listen, when you do what Jesus said, you'll find that he is better than anything that you ever had before in your life. When you do what Jesus says in your life, you'll find he's better than that philandering lifestyle that I had. He's better than me groping, trying to find satisfaction in the lust of the flesh and in the pride of life and all of these things. Listen, you get that bitter wine from Satan. What he does, he gives you the best first, and at the end, you get the worst. But with Jesus, you may have some struggles on this life. You may have what you think is the worst, but Jesus is always going to give you the best for last. Jesus is better. And what they learned here is that Jesus is better. Now listen, my dad's mom, and I may come back to this every Mother's Day, but one of the greatest advice earthly that I know that a mother ever gave a child was when my dad's mother told him, her name was Sarah Word. Matter of fact, we were talking about her, she was very similar to you, Sister Robinson. Straight shooter is what I mean. I remember being a little boy laying on the floor, and I was laughing, and my daddy told me to do something, and I guess I started whining. She said, "You remind me of my youngest son." And I swelled up with pride, and I said, "Do I?" She said, "Yeah, cry baby." Very similar to you, Sister Rice. But the greatest advice that she gave, my father, of course, some of you know, played football for Marshall University, was going to get on a plane to be with his team after his father had died. He was in Texas, and he was going to get back and get on the plane to play another team in North Carolina. And his mother said, "Listen, do not get on that plane." She said, "If that plane is going to crash." And my daddy was not saved at that time, but he listened to his mother. The next day, that evening, the plane crashed and killed all of his teammates. His life was spared. Why? Because he listened to your mother. Listen, you better listen to your mama. Especially your godly mother, you better listen to her. Listen, that was some great advice because that saved his life. I'm going to tell you this, though, and I love my grandmother and my daddy, but Mary gave some even greater advice. Because she said, whatever Jesus says for you to do, do it. And I'm telling you this morning, Jesus is telling those who do not know him, come unto me. Amen. Those who thirst, and I'll give you water which you'll never thirst again. Whosoever will may come. The greatest advice Jesus is telling the Christian in this place is, listen, follow me. Yes. Just follow me. And come to me by faith. He's a rewarder of those that diligently seek him and have faith in him. And listen, the reason I say that advice is even greater than my grandmother's advice that saved my daddy's life is because this advice can save your soul.
Yes.
And give you a new eternal destination.
Amen.
It's the difference between heaven and hell. Give you a new life. That's the greatest advice ever given. So the question this morning is this. Mothers, are you giving the same advice that Mary gave to your children? Whatever Jesus says, just do it. May not be popular, may not understand it, whatever Jesus. Listen, if I'm encouraging the moms this morning, you yourself can do just like Mary, and in your predicaments, there was no wine, what do I do? She went to her son, but like I said, really, she went to the Savior. In every situation in your life, you can run to Jesus.
Amen.
Mamas, when it gets tough, those single mothers in here, whatever the case is, you're married, but for your marriage, for your children, you go to Jesus.
Amen.
And just do whatever he says. But the invitation is this, mother, you live by Mary's advice. And you'll find that Jesus will come alongside you. He'll help you. He'll take those bitter waters and turn them into sweet wine in your life. But here's a challenge for you mothers. Teach your children the same advice that Mary taught those servants. Whatever he saith, whatever Jesus saith, do it. You need to teach your children that. And then finally, children. I'm not talking about just little kids. I'm talking about grown folk. Maybe your mother has encouraged you or tried to teach you in the ways of God. Have you taken that advice? And if your mother didn't, have you taken Mary's advice? Whatever Jesus tells you to do, just do it. Because you'll find when you do that, you'll find safety, you'll find direction, you'll find protection, you'll find provisions only under the umbrella of the obedience to Jesus Christ. Let's stand this morning.